Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Monday, March 13th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Would you first please stand and join me in Pledge of Allegiance to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Can we have the roll call, please?
Chairman Garvin.
Here.
Counselor Grennan. Counselor Caitlin Jordan.
Here.
Counselor Penelope Jordan.
Here.
Counselor Lennon.
Here.
Counselor Ray.
Here.
Counselor Sullivan.
Here.
Thank you. We'll start off with council reports and correspondence. I know we'll get the Finance Committee report in a moment, but are there any other reports to share at this time? Sarah?
Hi, I just wanted to announce that the Comprehensive Planning Committee has lost one member. He had to resign, so we are opening it back up. And I just wanted citizens to know and encourage people to apply. The deadline for the application will be Friday, March 24th. And if you are interested, go on the town website to recent news, and there you'll find a link that will bring you right to the application. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Any other correspondence or reports? Okay, seeing none. Jessica, finance report?
Yes, thank you. You all have the latest dashboard in front of you. This is the dashboard of the town's financial status as of February 28, 2017. Not hugely different from last month. Excise taxes are still coming in. We had a $49,000 in $49,560 in excise taxes, so our citizens are buying cars for sure. I would like to point out that we have we had a large debt service payment of $975,247, and that was mostly a bond payment on the library. So those are the highlights.
Thank you very much. Any questions for Jessica? Thank you.
Jamie,
go ahead.
If I might, and just ask, I'd like to just thank again Catherine Messmer and Matt Sturgis for meeting and going over these figures as we've been doing each month. Thanks again.
Appreciate it. At this point, is there any citizen who wishes to speak on an agenda, on an item not on tonight's agenda? Seeing none, we'll move to the town manager's monthly report. Matt?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll try to be concise this evening. The past month has moved by very quickly, with the primary concentration being placed on completion of the municipal budget, which you all have in front of you this evening. That work is now complete and will be presented at the end of this evening's agenda. Speaking of budgets, I also attended the school department budget meeting last week, along with Chairman Garvin and Councilors Sullivan, Lennon, and Penny Jordan, and I felt it was important to be there to have an understanding of their process and in support of their efforts. In additional news, last Thursday, the town received three bids for the recycling center upgrades. Bids were submitted by Dearborn Construction, Sargent Corporation, and Shaw Brothers Construction. Total bids ranged from $1.244 million to $1.382 million, with Dearborn Construction being the low bidder. Bob Malley, the Public Works Director, and Randy Tome from Wood & Curran will be reviewing the bids and looking for additional opportunities to value engineer some elements of the project to ensure the budget of $1.4 million will be held to, which they are confident they will be able to do. Construction is forecast to begin the week of April 10th. So we're excited about that project getting started. Applications for the vacant assessor position are coming in, with the closure date for application being this Friday. Speaking of applications, property owners are reminded to apply for the homestead exemption prior to April 1st. Or veterans exemption, or any other exemptions. Everything needs to be filed on or before April 1st. If you have moved to a new location in town or are new to Cape Elizabeth, or you have not applied before, please encourage you to apply. But if you have applied in the past, you do not need to for your existing home, if you already have it. Community Services has completed their spring and summer brochure. It's available online, and registration for upcoming programs will begin on March 26th online, March 27th for paper or in-person signups. And finally, I'll be attending a Maine Town and City Manager's annual interchange, with the focus being on preparing for recreational marijuana in Maine. And of note, the speakers will include former manager of Frisco, Colorado, to see what kind of changes they had. So we've got quite a program planned, so I think that'll be interesting to see in light of the moratorium we have here in town. So hopefully I come back with some good information for the town. But respectfully submitted, that is the manager's report. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Matt. Any questions for Matt? Thank you very much. Next item is the review of the draft minutes from our February 15th meeting. Entertain a motion to accept the minutes.
So moved.
Sarah, second?
A second.
Jessica, any comments, questions, discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Great. Next item up is number 50-2017, Tower Overlay District Request for Rezoning at 19 Wells Road.
I need to recuse myself because this is our property.
Okay, thank you very much. Caitlin?
I just have to state that I'm close friends with Penelope Jordan, Carol Ann Jordan, Pamela Butterfield, and William H. Jordan, Jr.
Okay. Anybody have concerns about Caitlin's participation in this motion, or this item, rather?
No, not hers, but just a point of order. Do we have to accept a recusal by vote of the council?
Yes, I believe.
I believe we do.
Okay.
So I move to accept Councillor Penelope Jordan's recusal from a discussion and vote on item 50-2017.
Is there a second to that? Sarah, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Thank you for that procedural point, Jessica. Return to the question of anybody having concerns about Caitlin's participation on this item. Seeing none, thank you. Thank you, Caitlin. Matt, did you want to introduce this item, or?
Oh, sure. Yes, we do. This is a request to have a rezoning or expansion of a cellular overlay zone for 19 Wells Road and to locate a cellular tower there. And McLean Middleton is the firm that's handling the I guess you could say, the legal legwork to bring this forward. And they have representatives here this evening who'd like to be come forward with a presentation. I think Victor Manoogian is going to get us started, and they have two other gentlemen as well who'd like to speak as well.
Great. Thank you very much. Please step to the podium.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. For the record, my name is Victor Manoogian from McLean Middleton Professional Association, and I appear tonight on behalf of Global Signal Acquisitions 4, LLC. With me tonight from Crown Council, to your right in the yellow tie is Paul Peckins, and to his left is Adam Barsotti, who's in-house senior counsel. Excellent job explaining what we're doing. Properties at 19 Wells Road, tax assessor map R05 lot 30-0. And tonight we're asking for this council under section 19-10-3 to forward this amendment for a zoning request to the planning board and initiate its formal review. With that, unless you have any questions of me, I'd like to turn it over to Adam, who will explain why we're here and why we need this.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, Victor. Thank you, members of council. I'm very excited to be here. I promise I did not bring the weather yet again. I'm here, as Victor said, on behalf of Global Signal Acquisitions. I'm in-house counsel. We're a division of Crown Castle. And just for the board's reference, Crown Castle is a company. We're the leading provider of wireless infrastructure in the United States. We have the most towers and other types of deployments. We were founded in 1994 and are listed on the S&P 500, so a very respected partner. A lot of what we do and a lot of our responsibility as the leader in the industry is partnering with communities like yours, local governments, to facilitate deployment of wireless facilities in both a reasonable way, but that also facilitates the need that we need for information and communication that we all rely on. So I appreciate your time. We're requesting your support and recommendation for our application to rezone. Just a point of clarification, too. We're intending to relocate an existing site. So our intention here isn't to build an additional tower in the community. We're going to take what's there. The intention is, should we need this alternate location, we would construct on the Jordan property, and then we would take down the existing site. So you would have a, you're not going to change the total net impact from a tower standpoint. The issue that we're encountering, we have a lease that is expiring. A lot of our towers are on leased property. We work closely with our property owners. From a relationship standpoint, that's how we've done so well over the years. But unfortunately, in this case, we just haven't quite come to terms, and it's requiring us to look at alternate sites, and that's why we're here. The existing overlay district is owned entirely by one family. So there aren't alternate possibilities within that geographic area. That's part of the reason for the expansion as well, because we're kind of up against a roadblock from that standpoint. The site at issue is critical to the communication network for the town. The town itself, as well as the local fire department, has radio equipment on this site. And our real intention here is just to ensure that there's uninterrupted network coverage for the citizens, for the government, for any users. I know this is a big tourism area. Tourists expect to have access to data all the time as well. So it's important that we keep this network in place, that we keep coverage in place, and ultimately, that's what we're trying to accomplish here, because expiration is bad for the town, it's bad for us. We want to secure this site or secure an alternate site long-term so that we can continue to operate, continue to have carriers on the site that can provide the coverage that the town needs, that public safety agencies need, and that the general public needs. Just to point to the map that's up on the screen, and you should have a handout of this as well. It gives you a sense of the geography here. Many of you are probably familiar with the Jordan Farm property, but the actual existing tower to where the new proposed location would be, if you go from the line of the overlay district to the new proposed site, it's 242 feet, I want to say. So I don't have a particularly good throwing arm, so I probably couldn't hit it, but someone in this room might be able to actually throw a baseball and hit it. So, but you know, these are necessary services, and we're requesting your consideration and hopefully your support as we try to move this to the planning board for a full review and approval. You know, just like when you're at home, when you flick that light switch, you expect the lights to come on. When you are stuck on the side of the road, or in my case, when you need to call your kids and tell them that you're going to spend an extra day in Portland because of the snowstorm, you expect that call to connect, and you expect that it'll go through and you'll be able to have that connection. So with that, I just wanted to, we'll open up the questions. I know Victor is going to fill in some more specifics on what our intended construction is going to be here, but we're hopeful to get your support and we can move to the next step in the process here. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Kathy?
At the sound of the, you know, I might sound stupid, but you don't have a, you know, something that you're showing us in terms of like the little red dot.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. Are you proposing that you're taking the tower from Strout Road and moving it down to the Jordan Farm property?
More or less, what would happen is you'd have an entirely new facility that would be constructed, and then the existing would be decommissioned once that one would be in place and everything moved over.
So the current tower is not going to be able to be kept there? I'm not sure I'm understanding.
So we're currently operating, the property owner has a lease mm-hmm. with Crown Castle. So, and it's for a term of years, and the term expires early 2019. So we're, from just a tower standpoint, that is no time at all. And obviously we have customers, we have wireless carriers that rely on us to provide infrastructure for their network. So for them, 30 years is too short. But obviously with 2 years, that's when we have to start looking at what are some other alternatives, because you know, it's too important for these for this infrastructure to stay in place. And if it's not going to stay in the current spot, that's what we're here asking for, is where this is the next best spot. I mean, it's literally right next door. It abuts the existing overlay. And from a geography standpoint, it'll have a minimal impact to what's currently there. You know, it'll look visually, it'll be very similar.
Follow-up question. It appears to me, which I don't know, but that would be a lot lower. Is this tower going to be a lot lower than where it is now? Because right now it's pretty high.
It should be at a similar elevation. The total height of the tower will be exactly the same, which is 180 feet. Okay. And the actual ground elevation on this portion of the Jordan property it's not a significant drop. Am I? It's 12 feet lower.
All right. Thank you. I wasn't understanding, because it looked like it was going to go a lot lower, and I was not understanding that you were also going to be decommissioning that other piece. So thank you.
You're welcome.
Sarah?
Sorry, I had trouble deciphering the map as well. So my question is, I'm picturing it up on the hill. Like, if I'm standing at Jordan Farm and I look up, it's back and away. It's not like on where they grow vegetables, right? You won't even barely see this from driving up Wells Road, any more than you see the current one.
Correct. Actually, what's proposed would be a slimmer profile. It would be a monopole, so you would actually see less than the current structure, which is a pretty bulky self-support.
And my other question is, I know we're just talking about a zoning issue right now. Do they need, again, the map thing I couldn't figure out, are you guys proposing to rezone their entire property, because that's how you would have to do it, or are you choosing a little area that you're going to rezone?
The way it's been submitted, it's the entire, it's a larger portion. I want to say it's about 67 acres. If there's a desire to limit it, we certainly don't need to rezone the entire 67 acres, so that's we'd certainly be open to that if that changes the thought process. But it's the top portion of the property away from the farm.
Northern portion of the property, according to the request here. Yeah.
Okay. The northern portion.
I guess that's something the planning board should consider.
Yeah. If it's not required to have the entire 67 acres, we would be open to reducing that.
I don't even know it's preferable. I'm just throwing it out there. But again, I think that's the planning board's expertise. So I was just curious.
Yep. Okay. Thank you.
I have a question. So there's almost 2 years to the expiration of the current lease. Is that correct?
Correct.
And I guess at what point, I understand that you're far enough along and that it must be at enough of an impasse in those negotiations that you're obviously have gone to the lengths of drawing up these plans and exploring alternative options. Have you discontinued negotiations with the current lessee or lessor?
Be the lessor.
Lessor to try and extend that? And I guess what I'm asking is in terms of likelihood of moving forward with this, is this a bit of a negotiation tactic to try and force and leverage the other negotiation, or are those negotiations complete?
My understanding is the negotiation right now is at an impasse. It's not to say that they couldn't reopen in the future. We don't bluff. We're not here because we want to. I shouldn't say that. I'm enjoying my time speaking with you, but we don't come here to bluff or to leverage. Our intention here is to provide a long-term solution for everybody. And obviously, there's another landowner that, you know, he could come back to the table. But right now, we're operating under the assumption that we have to have the plans drawn. We have to be prepared to relocate if we get to that drop dead date and we haven't found a solution.
So. Great. Thank you. Other questions? Go ahead.
Adam, and I'm not sure if Victor's going to come back to talk about this, but I know the fire chief and the police chief have reached out because we currently have a presence on the existing tower.
Correct.
And I know they've had some conversations with you. I don't know if you had if you could enlighten the council as to what the fruits of those discussions have been.
I think I'm going to defer to Victor, but okay. Just as a practice, we certainly encourage co-location with our local municipalities, in this case the fire department. So any move from the existing to the proposed would be we would typically handle that at cost. And then if there's no license fee now for their use, which I expect there probably isn't, that would continue as well. So the intention would be to minimize disruption. So it'd be like, you know, just seamless from their standpoint, make sure there's no, obviously you can't have any downtime with the fire department. Yeah. So, but, and Victor might have more specifics on that piece. Oh,
thank you.
Well, thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
I don't have much left between your questions and Adam's presentation, but I did speak to, I want to say, the fire chief, and he's on board, and his only concern was, am I getting kicked off, or are we going to be allowed to go on? I said, absolutely, same thing. And as Adam said, we do that for police if needed. The only thing I wanted to add briefly is what we're designing, and Catherine's question about the style. It's a 180-foot monopole, so all the cabling and wiring will be inside the pole. You won't see anything on the outside, and all you see is the antenna arrays at the top, usually at 10-foot separation, carrier to carrier. Verizon's going to be at 175 feet. AT&T is going to be at 165 feet. T-Mobile Dish is going to be at 152 feet. And below that, there's still room for two additional co-locating carriers. So we feel that'll you know, help take care of the needs of the wireless industry. And we feel this is in line with your 2007 Cape Elizabeth Comprehensive Plan. This will ensure that the farm owners can keep farming the land and use some of this revenue to pay higher taxes. We again ask your support to send this to the planning board, and we will have to do everything zoning-wise that they or other boards require in this town, and we look forward to you doing that for us.
Any questions for Victor? Thank you very much
Thank
for
you.
Your presentation. Appreciate it. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to refer this request for a tower overlay district rezoning at 19 Wells Road to the Planning Board pursuant to 19-10-3 of the zoning ordinance. Jessica?
I have a question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I just would like
there were no
to,
further questions.
Just for the record, confirm that we will be revisiting the issue after the Planning Board looks at it. So if the Planning Board were to go ahead and recommend a zoning change, it would come back to the Town Council again.
Great.
That's all I wanted to add. Thank you.
Confirmation.
So moved on the motion.
Thank you very much. Is there a second? Sarah, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion on the floor? Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Thanks, guys.
Next item on the agenda is item number 55-2017, a request for rezoning at 27 Fowler Road. Ahead, Matt.
This one up, sure thing. Yeah. This is a request that's been placed to the town by Brad Pearson for 27 Fowler Road. And Mr. Pearson's desire is to have the property rezoned to Business B, which is the abutting zone, which currently is Skip Murray's pit. And so he's looking to, in the future, he'd like to relocate his business back to Cape Elizabeth, and but he'd like to operate it from there. The constructs of the BV zone versus the RA zone, which it currently is, work a lot better with his plans as far as being able to place his business there. So, however, it's not as simple as just simply rezoning it, because there are issues related to setbacks and other issues that are in the BV zone that will need to also be discussed. So. Mr. Pearson has made that request, and his parents, who currently own the property, have also stated to me by email that they're in support of this request as well. So we do have the current property owner's, I guess you could say, consent to go forward with it. And Mr. Pearson is here if anybody would like to have any questions for him, but ultimately he'd like to see council consider this and then move it forward to the planning board, or refer to the planning board for further discussion, because it's a there'll be some substantive discussion that will have to take place at that level.
Great, thank you for that. Did you want to step forward and make any comment, or
If that answers our questions, I think we should have a...
Okay.
I have questions.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi. So my question is, we have circled around Carl Pearson's property, I'm sorry, Skip Murray's property a little bit because some neighbors find it noisy.
Correct.
And a kind of an impact on an otherwise residential neighborhood, trucks going back and forth and noise,
right,
and so forth. So I guess my question to you is, give me a visual of how you use it, like how many trucks are parked there and how frequently and what kind of noise.
Yep. Currently we have 8 to 10 trucks, pickup trucks, nothing larger than a 1-ton town size, small pickup per se, less than 10,000 pound truck. Usually my crew comes to the shop and then we leave during the day and we don't usually come back till say 5 o'clock, 4 or 5 o'clock at night. One or two cars coming in and out, or trucks per se, coming in, grabbing tools, and then leaving again. We moved out probably 2 years ago, just due to the fact of increased trucks in the fleet. But we were running, just my father and I, out of there for, ever since we moved there, pretty much, just him and I. All of our equipment was down back, and pretty much no noise besides trucks in the morning. Definitely not the traffic flow of back and forth to the pit every 15, 20 minutes with seven plus dump trucks every day. I mean, nothing more than what's going on right now, I'd say, out of Murray's side.
So what compelled you to request the change if this has been going on for years with your current...
I moved out. I'm in South Portland now. 2 years ago, we moved to South Portland just for the expansion of our fleet. I just didn't feel comfortable running in a residential zone with more trucks. I didn't really want to just run without a zone change. So I got out of town, and then my lease is up in 8 months, 10 months from now, and I'd like to purchase, or I was going to purchase, actually, right behind here at the old 1226 Shore Road. But after looking at the plan and setbacks and everything, it just looked as though there'd be a lot of groundwork to be within the town center zone. So after looking at the zoning map, I just thought it would be easier if we just expanded that and ran back out of there as we did 3 or 4 years ago. So.
Other questions? Kathy?
Question for the town manager. I'm not sure I understand, but I assume that the neighbors will be asked or notified and be asked for their input?
Yes, sir.
And the other question is, I would assume that the we considered this, or the planning board considered this, that all taxes would be paid up to date?
And a couple of things. I have spoken with one of the neighbors, who actually, I think, you're surrounded on two sides by
yep.
Murray's pit, right? I know Skip Murray didn't have an objection to it because it was obviously complimentary to what he had going on there. And I did, and when Brad and I spoke about this before, I said it would be a good idea, A, to let your neighbors know that you're thinking about going down this direction, but through the planning board process also, they'll notify. They have a certain radius within which they'll reach out to neighbors to let them know what's taking place or what the request is. So, and then with taxes, I don't think that we can actually stop people from going forward with that if they don't pay their taxes, like with zoning requests or anything along those lines. But so I don't think we can tie the two of those together, unfortunately.
However, that would be a consideration for the town council.
It's something for the council, that the council could consider. Yeah,
right.
Definitely. But as far as tying the two together from a zone change perspective, that part we can't do.
I understand.
Okay.
Thank
Sorry.
You.
Thanks.
No, thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Other questions? Jessica.
Yeah, I recall, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago when we had some neighbors on Fowler Road complaining about truck traffic from LP Marion Sons, and you know, this would increase truck traffic, for sure. The other question I have, or concern, is I believe, and correct me if I'm wrong, that LP Murray and Sons is Monday through Friday. Monday through Friday running business, not on weekends, but I'm not sure if that's the case with this business. This business might be working on weekends as well. And I don't know how that would, you know, affect residential neighbors. So just a concern. I'm sure the planning board will deal with that.
Yeah, I think they'd explore that pretty fully at that point. I'm not sure about as far as Murray's operations during the weekend. I know they do some retail out of there as well, but I'm not sure. Brad might be by now. I don't know if they do it on Saturday and Sunday.
I can't remember off the top of my head.
Yeah. So I know they sell mulch and other items there.
Yeah.
Other times of the week.
And again, as with the prior item, should the planning board decide to recommend this change that's requested, it will still come back to full council for approval or not.
Yeah, all zone changes have to come back. You know, at this point, you're just pushing that forward, and then it has to come back for a full public hearing, again, for confirmation.
Any other questions?
I don't have a specific question, but I just want to have you clarify once again, because it's a different type of truck that you're talking
correct.
About.
Correct. It's only a...
It's not...
It's a pickup truck.
Large dump trucks. It's... pickup trucks and things like that
correct.
Move out, go off and do work.
Do our work for the day and then
throughout
return.
The day. And that's what I heard you say initially to Sarah's question.
Exactly.
One of the things that I would ask is you also have employees.
Yes.
And so your employees will be coming to work at that site.
Correct.
And will parking be out in back of that building?
It'll be all behind. We've got like a terraced lot, more or less. It's like 12 feet below road line. So if anyone were to drive by, you literally can't see it from the road.
Okay.
So everything will be out of site plan, more or less.
And when your trucks are done for the day, the same thing?
Same thing. Yeah, it would. I mean, we ran for many years, and I could drive by the whole way and not see one piece of equipment down there. So,
okay. Great.
All right.
Thanks, Brad.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
At this point, does anyone want to make a motion to refer this item to the planning board pursuant to 19-10-3 of the zoning ordinance?
So moved.
Penny, is there a second? Caitlin, discussion? All those in favor of the motion? Thank you very much. Next item up is number 56-2017, extension of license for the Spurwink Rod and Gun Club. Did you want to introduce this, or I'm happy to?
Sure thing.
Go ahead.
As council knows, there's been quite a discussion over the past couple of years over Spring Rod and Gun Club and going through the firing range committee. What we have this item on the agenda for this evening is for an extension for the Rod and Gun Club's license to operate. And because it has expired as of November. However, the council or the town also needed to have a firing range committee, which did not get populated. So from that side of it, there wasn't a body that was able to act on the extension of their license. So and as you may recall, back in February, the council met and sent to the ordinance review committee the opportunity to make some revisions to the firing range ordinance as it currently stands, with some technical revisions and other discussion points that they're going to be working on. After speaking with Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, she thought, after speaking with the committee, that they were going to have the ability to work on that over the next couple, 3 months, probably have something back by May. I know members of the committee could correct me if I'm wrong on that, but I think that's what her stated goal was. So with that being said, the recommendation has been made to see if we could extend the license so that would allow the committee to get their work done and then come back then with the new, in a sense, with the new rules in place at that point, or recommend rule changes in place after they've been ratified by the council, then they could extend their license or renew their license at that point in time after the questions that needed to be clarified have been clarified. As a background to this as well, I had the opportunity to meet with Tammy Walter and Mark Mayone on Friday with Ben McDougall, our code officer, just to have a brief discussion with A, to let them know that this is going to be on the agenda, and B, to follow up on some questions that the council might have had, in order so you can make a better or more informed decision. And so we had a very pleasant meeting, got together. Ms. Walter and Mr. Mayone provided me evidence of their insurance, and they have a current plan that's in place, and it's it has significant levels of coverage. Also, there have been no complaints that have been lodged with the code officer as far as from the operations of the club. And then thirdly, I've followed that up with conversations with the chief of police to see if the police had received any additional complaints, and then there were none on record to have been received by the police. So all in all, it seems like the intensity of the interest that had been generated over the past couple of years at this point has subsided some due to the presence of the ordinance and the changes that have been made at the club. So with that backdrop, I guess that's why my recommendation or my item that I brought forward was to extend for 90 days so they could move forward and everybody could live happily ever after.
Great. Thank you for that background, Matt. Tammy or Mark, did you want to step forward to say anything on this?
Good evening. Mark Mayone, Spurwink Run and Gun Club. We feel as though if we could have about a 6-month extension for the licensing. And the only reason that we ask that it go out so far is that we're operating now. We're in a good place. Stuff happens as summer comes in. We realize council's going to get maybe even a little busier. So we figured rather than come back in 3 months after for another extension, just do 6 months, and I'm sure everything will be cleaned up by then. So from our standpoint, we're already operating. We're in a really good place. So I forgot what I was going to say. Does anyone have any questions about the operation of the club now that we've been going for about a year? We're really proud of it. We're doing newer things down there. We've done some sound things down there that no one's tried anywhere in the country, at least from what I've seen, and I live this stuff. And that seems to be working out well. We just changed up our electronic security system. We dumped a bunch of money into it and made it considerably better than even what we had 6 months ago. We're really proud of that. And that's about to come up online very shortly here.
Great. Thank you, Mark. Are there questions for Mark? Sarah?
Thank you. I went down there and saw it. I was really impressed. So it seems like there's a lot less noise. I don't know if that's because it's winter and no one wants to shoot guns, or whether that's the result of the improvements, or whether it's because the 50-yard range. What do you think? I used to be able to hear from my house, and now I can't anymore.
You're not the only person who's mentioned that to us. One of my members actually said to us when we first opened up, there are some quotes that I remember. One of them said, doesn't read his newsletter, which sometimes, and he said, "Are we opened up yet?" And I said, "We're not only open, we're using every caliber." I said, "Everything's, you're allowed to use whatever you want." And this is 3 months after we opened. He says, "I always used to hear you. I never hear you, so I figured you weren't opened up yet." Another comment was from a neighbor in the Cross Hill development. Just because I kind of like to get a little feedback from the neighbors, I'll call some of them every once in a while. And their comment was, "We're nervous about when the 50-yard opens up and you start using more than 22 caliber firearms." And 22 caliber firearm is a bullet that's about that big, very small very quiet. And my response to him was, we're using everything. We're using stuff from that to stuff like this. And he was absolutely amazed. So fortunately, we do have a neighbor in the room tonight who could probably, from my standpoint, the noise means nothing. So getting my opinion really, I guess, doesn't count. And I don't mean to discount your opinion. It's just my opinion's really biased. So, I mean, I think asking a neighbor's standpoint on it would probably be a more accurate reflection of what you're looking for.
And then my other question is membership steady increase? Because I think for a while it had dipped a little bit after it was closed. Is it back up? What's the membership now?
Our membership seems to be chugging along steady. We seem, it's a little bit low now that we're not in the thick of things. It's tough to say. We're right, usually March is when people wait to the last minute to pay their dues. So all of a sudden there's a big flood of people who come in and pay, usually in the last 2 weeks. So right now we're in the first 2 weeks, so it's kind of hard to guess where we are. We're also making every member come in this time around, where we haven't done that in decades, because part of the new security system requires that they come in, we see who they are, I don't want to get too much into our security, but we have to see them, we have to verify who they are for them to be into the security system.
Thanks.
Yeah. Anybody else have questions? I have a quick question. I know that this particular item and why we're talking about it here tonight is a little bit because things got, for lack of a better term, kind of lost in the
Sorry.
Nope. It's okay. with the transition of committee and no applicants for the firing range committee, things got kind of lost in the shuffle. I was just curious, did you guys, were you aware that your license had lapsed or
no.
expired? No. Okay.
I knew it was, no.
Okay.
No. If I could, one more thing.
Sure.
Because I love to plug the club. Should be really proud of what's down there. I was just on the phone with a guy from, I think, out in Indiana last month, asking us about our club. Tammy sees it around the state. People are really curious. We've had all kinds of interest. Some of it scares people. Some of it really encourages them. We've had people who are really big in the shooting industry who see our club who are like, this place is amazing. And it's right here in our backyard. So we should be really proud of, I hope you're as proud as I am that we have this amazing facility in our, right here. So anyway.
Great. Thank you very much. Okay. Oh, sorry, didn't see your hand up.
Actually, I don't. I'd like to make a motion that we extend the license for the Spurwink Rod and Gun Club. I'd like to add a lot, and you probably won't like to hear it, but I'm going to anyway. I've dealt with this for 6 years. I was chair of the ordinance committee. I was chair of the council. I sat here when there were over 200 people in this room. And I think we had a pretty good ordinance at the time. And Caitlin probably will say, yeah, yes, no, or whatever. But at the time, we did a pretty good job, I think, at putting together an ordinance. The ordinance was something that came right down the middle for the people who were very upset and the gun club people who wanted to continue on with their gun club. This has recently come back to the ordinance committee, and we've had our meeting, and Caitlin can confirm that, but we are working on it. There are some things that have changed, some things that we think we should tweak. It's been a little while, and so I think that we should give the 90-day period because I think that we can probably bring it back to the council. Caitlin thinks differently. She can speak up. But I think that we are going to bring back some tweaks to the ordinance that hopefully will be satisfactory to most, many. So anyway, I make a motion to extend the license for 90 days.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay. Discussion? Caitlin?
I agree with most of what you said. My only concern with the 90 days is the procedurally. Like, it's probably going to take us at least a month to get it done. And then it's going to come back to the council. And then should it be approved then, it's going to take 30 days once it's approved to go into effect. So I'm just wondering if 3 months is enough time or, you know, that's my only question. I mean, is procedurally, can, if it all happens as quick as possible, is 3 months reasonable or is 6 months more realistic so that we make sure everything gets completed and then they still have some time to have some wiggle room for whatever tweaks get put in there? That's my only toss out there.
I'd like to jump in with my opinion maybe earlier in the discussion than later. I think that we should be separating the issue of changes to the existing ordinance and extending the license under the terms of the current ordinance. We have a situation where, through nobody's ill intent, the license has expired. If this was a situation where some, you know, one of the establishments in town that serves alcohol and we had inadvertently had their license lapse, we would be renewing, you know, we'd be entertaining a request to renew their license. I think in this case, if it's extended beyond 90 days, we've effectively gone, you know, in the case of 6 months, what Mark is suggesting, a full year in between when their license expired and what that extension is for. What I'd rather see is an extension. There's, you know, there's no burden on the applicant that I'm aware of to apply for a license renewal. There's no fee associated with it or anything like that. What I'd rather see is us extend it so that they're operating with a current and valid license, have them reapply if in that time we've changed the ordinance and they're applying under new terms of the ordinance, so be it. If not, they may then have to apply again when that ordinance, if it passes. Who knows what's going to happen with our deliberation on that issue? So I'd like to separate and decouple those two things because I don't think the ordinance revisions are really relevant to the fact that they're operating with an expired license right now. And I'm not placing any blame on you for operating with the expired license because it's more our fault than yours, frankly, but it is what it is. And so it's just, we can't put the toothpaste back in the tube, but we can try and just bring everybody current on the procedures that we have today. So that's my opinion on it. Others, comments, questions?
My only comment to that is you're saying there's no burden on them to reapply. Or the ordinance, I think, states a renewal will happen. But one of the problems with the ordinance, because it was the best product that could be drafted at the time. I totally agree with Kathy on that. We did our darndest, and we thought we did it right. But there's actually no procedure for a renewal other than the firing range committee will reinspect the range. And so that's the burden, is they had nothing to do to renew. So we kind of have to wait and see what the new tweaks are going to say for what the procedure is for a renewal, unless the firing range committee, that is us now, wants to go reinspect the range, which we don't even know what that means, because what kind of an inspection are we to do? So I'm just saying it's yes, I agree, you have to separate them, but it's hard to say that there's no burden on them. They can just reapply, but it's not that simple, in my opinion.
But we could easily do another extension. In other words, 3 days before 3 months is up, we put it back, or the last council, if you guys haven't finished or we're finding there's snags, we could just do what we're doing here, only presumably it wouldn't even require this much conversation. I mean, I guess I'm slightly in favor of staying with the language that's here, just because in general I think that's preferable, and in the interest of ruffling no feathers, you know, we can just pass this, and I think another extension would be, if need be, we could do another, and it could be for the amount of time we anticipate. And that's just my feeling, but I think it's not, it doesn't seem like a huge issue, though, because they're not applying for a license, it's just they're being granted an extension. So in other words, we're just saying legally, officially, they can keep going.
Penny?
I'm confused. And I am because I, in essence, agree with where Jamie is at with separation, because if you step back and say, pretend we didn't get into the situation where the license wasn't applied for renewal, they would be working under the existing ordinance in order to do that. So if we say that, move forward with this, you know, separating them, that we want to get this license so that we have a so that the Rod and Gun Club has their valid license, and that can't be challenged by anybody. And then if the when the new ordinance comes through, then we see how that falls out, because there must have been something under the existing ordinance that would have allowed licensing to happen.
My understanding, sorry, is that it just says, there's like one line that says under the section municipal hearing that the firing range committee shall reinspect the range to renew the license annually.
But I couldn't mean, we do that?
Hmm?
Can't we do that?
Right, we could, but do you know how to inspect?
You're saying, so what you're saying is, under what criteria are we going to use in order to do the inspection?
And we can go to 90 days. I have no problem with that. I was just saying it seems silly to do a 90-day extension if you need 120 days. I was just asking procedurally, can we honestly get back here within a three-month time frame if that's what we were looking to do? That was all I brought up, was procedurally,
no,
was it possible?
It's a fine thing to bring up, but sometimes people need clarification on what's the essence of the point. And the point is, what criteria are we going to use in order to inspect the Rod and Gun Club?
Chairman Garfield.
Kathy.
One of the things I think we need to consider is that we're talking about extending the license. We're not talking about renewing.
Okay.
And I say this, there was some real difficulties with this, and I think that Councillor Sullivan remembers this.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. Me too. There were people who extended the truth. There were people who went to the state and I don't want to say alternative facts. And I am concerned that if we don't extend it at the moment, that we are going to get the same, we're going to give an opportunity for folks to start to say, there's a hole. We're going to plug this hole. We are going to fight this hole. We are going to say all kinds of things that may or may not be true. I think a lot of us heard that before. I, for one, do not want to hear it again. I want to extend the license for the moment, deal with it, I think, in the next 90 days. And the ordinance committee can come back to the council and say, we can't deal with it in 90 days. We have some issues. We have some suggestions. We have some thoughts, whatever. I don't want to start what we had before. Whether we agree with each other or not, that's okay. But I think that we need to extend it for now. And if the ordinance committee comes back to the council and says, we need more time, we have some issues, we have whatever, then the council can deal with that. The council can decide yes, no, whatever in between. But for me, I think we need to extend it right now for the 90 days and then let the ordinance committee deal with it and come back to the council. So that is my suggestion. I'm not trying to be unpleasant, but it was very unpleasant in the past for lots of reasons and for lots of people. And, you know, there may be people in the room that disagree, and that's okay. I mean, we can agree to disagree and not be unpleasant, but it became very unpleasant in the past, and I don't want that to happen again. I want to deal with it and then move forward. So I will stick with my motion to extend the license for 90 days. And so, thank you.
Jessica.
Yep, I'm going to support the motion and the town manager's recommendations. I agree with Chairman Garvin that these are separate issues. I see no reason not to grant this extension tonight.
Thank you.
3 months.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion to extend... To extend the license to operate the Spurwink Rod and Gun Club for a period of 90 days effective today, March 13, 2017. Opposed? Thank you very much. Thank you for your time tonight. Appreciate it. Item number 57-2017. Should be 7, not 8?
18.
Is it supposed to be 18?
Yep, we're on 2018.
But shouldn't that be 2017?
Oh,
no.
Yeah.
But the year.
Yes.
Sorry.
There's just a small typo in the agenda. It should be item 57-2017, not 2018.
I've been living in fiscal year 2018 for about a month now, so.
We're looking at a small cell telecommunication infrastructure item. Lots of cell towers tonight.
Cell is the word, Mr. Chairman.
Here you go.
This evening we have a request. Let me tee this up by saying there's a new technology that's developed since the year 2000, and it is this small cell technology, which is something that didn't exist back in 2000. That was the last time that those telecommunication amendments were addressed in the zoning ordinance. So over that period of time, you know, the advancements have taken place, and they've created this new form of cellular provision. Now, the council has had a goal of 100% cellular coverage for Cape Elizabeth. And so what happens is, or just happened recently, was that Verizon has come forward with an application, or they came in initially with an application to install one of these small cell technologies down at the end of Richmond Terrace. And Ben McDougall, our code officer's hitch up on this was that in the ordinance it states that concealment is required if he's going to be able to grant a building permit for that, or to at least to have that as the mechanism by which it can be legally installed without having to go to the planning board for review. This failed the concealment question. If you think about concealment, it would be if you located within inside of a church steeple or inside of a larger building, and it means what it states. So Ben's decision was to refer it to the planning board, which was what the ordinance had instructed him to do. But that now raises another question that the planning board needs to consider, and that is, okay, each time one of these installations come in, are they going to be referred to the planning board for permission to be installed? So each time that you wanted to do that, similar to years ago when the council used to approve pole permits. So if CMP or Verizon wanted to install a new telephone pole or electricity pole, it used to come to the council. So her concern is, A, would they be having to review each one of those as they come? Because this is probably the wave of the future, because it's a lot more easily deployable, and considering contrast to the large tower we were talking about earlier, it's more cost-effective. They can get it into more places and try to expand. It's not a panacea to poor coverage. So you probably wouldn't see one of these installed in Broad Cove, although I don't think there are any telephone poles in Broad Cove. I think most everything's underground there, if I recall correctly. So they're kind of going in that direction. So the question that they have is, A, how does this jive in relationship to the council's goal of wanting to have 100% cell coverage? And B, do you want to refer this to the planning board so they can make revisions to the ordinance so they can decide, okay, this is how this actually needs to go now that we know about this technology that exists versus strict delivery but via the large towers and having to have an overlay. Instead, we could have these extensions for these small cell communications, small cell towers. The other part of that is, would you like to have, or could they craft the language in the ordinance to allow certain parameters by which it could be approved? So if they met a specific design or something along those lines, or if they met certain requirements, they could be instantly building permitted, or trying to find some hybrid approach that might exist between the two. So if, say, they had one design that came forward, if they were changing that, it would have to go back to the planning board. Or if they had one universal design, would that be fine as long as it met what the town council felt was the area to go in? So the policy question that exists is, for the planning board side of it, they need some direction, I guess, ultimately from council or clarification in the ordinance as it currently exists. So that's kind of why it's bubbled up to this level now. So I guess ultimately the action that's required or requested from the council is to refer the telecommunications regulations to the planning board for their review and the update, and trying to, A, align those with the council's stated goals, but B, also take into consideration how the new technology is being deployed. And to kind of briefly describe what this small cell technology is, it's, in a sense, you would look at your Verizon pole or your Fairpoint pole that sits out there, and there's a box that's installed onto the pole, and then above that, it's almost like they extend the telephone pole by another 5 or so feet. That's where it fails the concealment test. It's also how they have to install it. So it's we have received, with your agenda packet, there is a handout that I provided as well that kind of gives you some good background on that. I think the council also did receive the emails from the Richmond Terrace neighborhood. There's, I think, 5 different property owners in there, maybe plus or minus one. It's either 4 or 5 who have weighed in and stated that they're not exactly comfortable with that. But I think they can also bring their thoughts to the planning board as they may go forward with that. And as one final point of record, the application to install that has been withdrawn at the present time. So it kind of bought the town a little bit of time to make the decision as to what direction you may want to go in. But it's coming, I guess. This is where the industry in many ways is going. But the other point I'd also like to say, you read a lot of the language that's out there, it almost sounds like you have no choice on how you come out to regulate it. You do have the choice to do that, and the article actually discusses that to some point. So, but you need to get ahead of it, because when we try to respond to it after the genie's out of the bottle, it starts to get a lot more difficult. So, that's kind of why planning board, instead of having to wrestle with it in a month from now, they can at least start going in one direction and discussing it and coming back, then the town can have a plan to go forward in the future.
So just to clarify, and a not insignificant, but last point that you kind of raised, the specific application for this has been withdrawn?
At the present time.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, they had come in, and then they made the referral to the planning board, and then they had a discussion with Maureen, and she did not dissuade them to go to the planning board level. They had a discussion about it, and she said, well, the council may, or the town may want to look at this as a larger policy question, And I think they pulled that just in case to see, you know, how that conversation was going to evolve.
Okay. Thank you for that. Just to also, one second, so if we were to make a motion to refer to the planning board a review of these ordinance provisions and so on, it also sounds like what is being asked of us is to, in doing so, provide them some degree of direction in terms of what our intent is, correct? Is that how I'm reading?
I think they're looking for an affirmation of what the council's earlier goal was for cellular coverage improvement.
Okay, thank you very much. Jessica, go ahead.
I'm not sure that I'm in support of sending this to the planning board yet, because, you know, looking through the materials for tonight, it seems to me that there's a larger policy question here, because I understand that this is probably the wave of the future, but we're potentially looking at a lot of these things all over town. I mean, that seems to be what might be in the future, and I'm wondering if it might be a good idea to get more information, have a workshop. I would like to be a lot more comfortable with what this is and what these things, you know, could potentially be throughout town. I don't know how much of a span they have, you know, how much coverage they actually bring, and we certainly want to improve our wireless coverage, absolutely. But I think and luckily that application is withdrawn. I think this is an opportunity for us to get into the weeds with this and be a lot more familiar with what we're talking about before we even send it to the planning board for their thoughts, because I think this is a big policy decision.
Thank you. Sarah?
I agree with Jessica. That's what I was going to say. I mean, this reminds me a little bit, although maybe it's less work, with the windmills, how we approach that. So I was just going to ask why we're sending it to the planning board, because doesn't the planning board usually do a specific property and a specific question? So I'm wondering, should we send it to the ordinance committee, not to dump more work on your desk, or should we should we put this in one of our workshops with some other items? I mean, I agree with Jessica. This is big. We need big picture down to small, and it seems like the planning board would be small up to big. So I don't get what, especially now that the applicant, there's no debt. It doesn't seem like there's a time pressure here. Does that make sense? Like, I feel like tonight we can't really carve out what kind of direction we want to give the planning board, because I feel like I need to look at more pictures and talk to people. But that's just, I mean, I'm not opposed, because the planning board would just come back and then we would do it. It just seems like maybe we'd be wasting their time a little bit if we don't do our work first.
Other questions, comments? There's actually a company here in Portland that's a fast-growing company that does this kind of work, called Tilson Technologies. And there might even be some people at the company that live in Cape, I don't know. But they do all sorts of network deployment and things like that. I'm on their website right now. And I agree that it would be good to have a workshop on this. And I'm even thinking that it might be worth sort of basically inviting a local expert that knows about it. The type of work they do is the same stuff that's outlined in the article that was appended to our packet. So inform us, get us smarter about it. I think it's ironic, not surprising, but ironic, that one of the number one things that we've all heard all throughout town as councilors and citizens is how, you know, poor the cell coverage is in town. So here are solutions that remedy that problem, but then there's blowback about, well, I don't want it in my backyard. So in any case, you know, I think it's a stated goal that we have. I think it's something we've heard clearly from residents of what they want. So I think we need to get smart about what the implications are. Are we to move forward on any of these things? So I agree on the workshop idea, and I don't know if we need to make a motion to specifically refer to a workshop, a future workshop, but if that's the desire of the council, I'll entertain that motion now. Jessica.
I move that we refer information on small cell telecommunication infrastructure to a future workshop for the council's knowledge.
Is there a second? Kathy? Any discussion? Matt?
Just a quick question. Would you like to do that in April?
Whenever it fits in.
April's kind of jammed up with the budget stuff.
We're kind of in a 60-day holding pattern right now, but you think May would be good?
May would probably be better, just given the budget.
Okay, perfect.
Agendas in April.
Yep, okay. I'll work with Deb and the chairman then to.
Yeah, and we can, whether it's this particular company, I happen to know about them, but whether it's this particular company or somebody else, I'm sure that there's somebody that we can work with.
Yep, we can reach out.
To provide that kind of information.
Thank you.
Other discussion? All those in favor of the motion? Great, thank you. Next item is number 58-2017, recommendation from the Appointments Committee to fill slots on the Recycling and Thomas Memorial Library Committees. Sarah?
Yeah, thank you. Two spots came up on the Recycling Committee and one for the Thomas Memorial Library Committee, and we were delighted that some great citizens came out to apply. We thank them very much, and what we have here is the slate for your approval, so I am moving that we approve the recommendation of our Appointments Committee to fill three spots. For the Recycling Committee, we proposed Chelsea Torrey from Linwood Street and Tim Trakimowicz. We had a whole conversation in his interview about his last name. From Granite Ridge Road for the Recycling Committee, and Gwyneth McGuire from Old Colony Lane for the Thomas Memorial Library Committee.
Thank you very much. Is there a second? Jessica?
Second.
Any discussion? Tim's son is affectionately known as Track by by my son and many of his friends in sixth grade. Any discussion? None. All those in favor of the motion? Great, thank you very much, and thank
Jeremy,
you to.
Sorry, can I add something?
Go ahead.
For folks who have just tuned in, I want to just repeat again that a spot has come open on the Comprehensive Planning Committee, which is actually an exciting and interesting committee with a 2-year charge that meets once a month. So if anyone out there is interested, applications are due by Friday, March 24th, and if you go to the town website, you will find a description of it and a link to the application. So please, if you're interested, do submit your interest, and we will meet soon to review them. Thank you.
Thank you for that, and thank you to these three citizens who are volunteering of their time and talent. It is much appreciated. Last item on the agenda for tonight is number 59-2017, the proposed municipal budget. I suppose you have a few things to say about this?
Just a couple, Mr.
Chairman. Mr. Manager.
Thank you very much. As you've noticed in front of you all this evening, I've produced and provided the fiscal year 2018 municipal budget for the town of Cape Elizabeth. I just want to say I'm very excited about this. It seems like it's been a labor of love. For the first item up that I had on my agenda or personal agenda to get completed, I'm very happy to have done it. And I wanted to take the opportunity to also thank all the department heads who worked extremely hard to bring this document forward so we could get this completed on time and on schedule for the council to consider and begin our budgetary process. You'll notice that this budget, as it's currently constructed, would add 11 cents to the tax rate, or 2.6% to the municipal portion. This is a proposed increase of 0.6% to the overall tax rate. I guess needless to say, this is a very conservatively crafted budget that I brought forward. The total combined municipal and community services budget last year was $12,052,000. And this budget proposes a budget of roughly $12,221,000 for an increase of $168,402, or an increase in spending of 1.4%. So that's I'm extremely happy about that, just doing the math and seeing that develop. This is impacted with a revenue decrease, unfortunately, from sources other than property tax of $44,330, or roughly 0.9%. The amount to be collected, additional valuation from new construction provides about $110,500 in new tax revenue. And so the net bottom line comes down to a 2.6% increase for existing unchanged properties, meaning if you hadn't done any difference between last year and this year to your house, if you hadn't added on or taken anything off, you'd be looking at a 2.6% increase from the municipal side. So the first question is, why is spending due to increase $168,000 or 1.4%? Well, there are a number of factors. Many of them are smaller numbers that add up to the overall, but there are four factors that come into place from personnel expenses. This year, there's an increase of $33,283 to personnel expenses, and that's 20% of the increase. Personnel-related costs in total are about $6 million, or roughly 49% of the total budget. $48,000 of the increase is related to a contractual increase with facilities with the facilities department. They're looking to add a part-time administrative assistant to the department, and they're doing a fairly substantial restructuring with responsibilities going to different areas. That represents roughly 29% of the increase in the budget. $10,000 of the increase relates to the transfer to the rescue fund to try to help offset the improvement of 24/7 coverage expansion that was implemented this past year, and that is a 6% increase. That's 6% of the increase. The intent is to add that amount for the next couple of years, as the rescue fund has a balance that may allow it to operate at a deficit for the short term, but in the long term, it's going to need an inflow to ensure that expenses are met. It's close, but it's not completely there yet. And finally, $30,000 of the increase relates to an increase in the tree budget. And that's to attempt at offsetting the projected impact that we may find in the coming year to the infestation of winter moth. So that's a best guess estimate that's been brought forward to try to offset that, but it's a very large concern with the winter moth infestation in town, especially thinking about the older growth trees that we do have and where they may impact them. So this will help us manage those trees, as well as make some cuts that may have to happen to the trees, not to the budget, what it's worth. those four above amounts represents approximately 72% of the proposed increase overall. There's also, we have within your packet, we have a substantial CIP request. Most of that has all been funded. We had a couple of deletions that will take place from last, that were proposed for next year, but we're actually taking care of them this year, and that is specifically the audio in this room is going to be improved this year in this year's budget. We had some savings that we could carry forward, and the IT department has worked and is currently set that out to RFP to try to get a good competitive bid to come forward, but we should be able to take care of that in the current budget. And then another item that we had was they have what they call a gas boy over at the Public Works Department, which is a fuel management dispensing system, so kind of is your computerized gas pump, to really summarize it. That's being done this year as well. So that we took those savings out of the current out of next year, and we applied it to this year. The lion's share of our CIP is related specifically, or the lion's share of it is in Public Works area. So we're looking at Hillway and Scott Dyer Road, and some paving and drainage improvements. There is a new street sweeper involved, so those items there take up a good portion of it. Then a number of other items that are also in there proposed for Fort Williams Park, as well as for Portland Headlight, and those are being funded out of funds that are specifically generated by those areas. So we're going to try to let them use the properties to pay for what needs to take place over there. And then you can look at our revenues when you do get the opportunity to take a look at those. There were a couple of areas that we did find that were dropped from last year to this year. First and foremost is, the largest single item of revenue that we are not getting is $53,000 change that we would have received from Scarborough from the assessing contract. So that was one of our larger areas that we were down from. And then there were some rights, I'd call it right-sizing of the revenues related to community services. With this being year two, we now have a pretty decent track record to understand what their revenue stream looks like in comparison to last year when it was mostly estimated. So we've corrected some of those numbers to be more in line with what their actuals are. And miscellaneous revenues I shrunk that number down because that's all over the place, to be blunt. So, you know, some years you receive more miscellaneous revenues than maybe, you know, state of emergency that gets declared, and we get reimbursement from the federal government or from the state that you can't count on from one year to the next. But we were carrying $98,000, almost $99,000 in there, and I reduced that down to $75,000. That's the only one I didn't have a good firm grip on, because it is, I went back and looked through it historically, and there, you cannot really tie your horse to it. And then revenue sharing as well, I've adjusted that to what the, basically we're tracking that in line with what we received this current year. We did receive estimates on Friday that we're looking to get about 402, and I'd forecast 416. So we may have to reconcile that as we get later in the budgetary process. But again, the legislature is really early in their session, so those numbers are fairly fluid. We may be safer just to keep tracking what we were anticipating from one year to the next. And then on the personnel side, I will say all of the budgets, or from the departments, there were no significant growths. The only thing that we found was that all of them placed in a 2% increase from on the salary line. But there were reductions at the library, assessing code and planning in particular, as well as in administration. As I was saying to the department heads today, we found some savings on the personnel line in administration because there's a rookie town manager who's not getting paid as much as the prior one. So I was happy to be part of that savings. So I did say that firmly, tongue in cheek, but I do think that when it comes down to it, we are looking at looking from the departmental side of it, very conservative budgets. There's not a lot of wants in there, but there are needs. But you'll notice that there are not significant changes that take place all the way through in all of them. I cannot stress enough my appreciation for the department heads for what they have done to bring this forward to make it easier so I can get my job done, but B, to also, for a first year budget to not come in with a choking increase and to try to have to figure out how to reconcile that was greatly appreciated by myself. But they did do yeoman's work, as well as I wanted to thank Deborah Lane for posting this morning to onto the town website. So we do have that available now if people want to take a look at it. And Partners Printing also came through huge for me today, because I was here on Saturday and printed it all off, and they bumped some people today to help us so I could get the document here for us tonight. So, but I look forward to discussing this as we go forward next week, and I think everybody else is looking forward to it too. So happy to answer any questions or save that for future. The one action that we have from this is from the council is the recommendation to refer it to the Finance Committee for additional discussion.
Great. Thank you very much, Matt. So before we do that, are there any brief questions that anybody has, or receive that for the workshop? Great. So if somebody would like to make a motion to refer the proposed fiscal 18 municipal budget to Finance Committee. Jessica?
I move that we forward the proposed municipal budget to the Town Finance Committee.
Second?
Second it.
Penny, any discussion? All those in favor? Great, thank you very much. Any citizens here that wish to speak on anything before we adjourn? Seeing none, motion to adjourn.
Wait, I think she wants to speak. Do you want to speak?
No.
No.
I'm just over the
board. Motion to adjourn?
Yeah. So moved.
Jessica, second. Kathy, all in favor? Thank you, everybody. Have a good night.